Hello there, and welcome back to the booth here at ProTour Aether Revolt. That is Ian Duke. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe. We're down the stretch, kids. It is the last round of Swiss, and this is going to determine a lot of the structure for our top eight. We've got some people that are going to be drawing or are already locked coming in. You got to hear about that from Brian Dave Marshall and from Luis Scott Vargas up at the news desk, but now we're going to focus in on what is for sure a win and in match for Lucas Esper Berthoud. If he wins, he's in. That's just a fact. On the other side of the table, Dimitrius Triantafillou from Greece, he's a win and probably. He's sitting at 11-4 right now, but with the best tiebreakers. So if he's able to stay with only four losses on his record, by winning this match, he's very likely to stay with the best tiebreakers and win and make this into a win and in for himself. It's not a lock quite like it is. Let's talk about the matchup. It's Mardu vehicles for Lucas. On the other side of the table, Dimitrius is playing Black-Green Constrictor. This is kind of the matchup we've seen a lot today.
Yeah, it's really characterizes the weekend. We've saw it a bunch before. We'll probably see it in the top eight as well,
yeah.
In some form or another. And this is a matchup that can go either way. You know, this is not a case where, we talked about the big three decks this weekend, right? There's the Black-Green Constrictor decks. There's Mardu Vehicles decks, and there's Copycat decks. Right? There's different flavors of all these things. Maybe the black-green deck is Jund, maybe it has energy, maybe it doesn't, and so on and so forth. But those are kind of the big macro archetypes of the weekend here. And this is not a case where we're playing rock, paper, scissors between these three. Any of these three can win against the other one, and it's really going to come down to just the strength of the draw, and in a lot of cases, the interaction. With Aether Revolt, we have some really strong new removal spells. Fatal Push, of course, we still have Unlicensed Disintegration, Shock entering the metagame as well. So all of these pieces are going to be kind of what determines the early game and determines who can stick their engine piece. In the case of the Black-Green deck, it's Winding Constrictor. In the case of the Vehicles deck, I would argue it's Heart of Kirin or maybe Gideon. That's kind of the engine there.
Yeah, Heart of Kirin's done a lot of work this weekend. Okay, we're ready. We've got one more round to go of the Swiss, and we've got a winning in. Let's head down to the feature match area for round 16 here from Pro Tour Aether Revolt. Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Aether Revolt. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Ian Duke, and we've got a big match on our hands here, Ian. It is the last round of Swiss, round number 16, and we've got two players who are very likely playing for top eight. You can see Dimitrius Triantafillou. He is playing Black Ring Constrictor. He's from Team Conflagrease. On the other side of the table, it is Lucas Esper Berthoud. He is playing Mardu Vehicles. He represents Team Dex Third. And the way this is going to break down here is it's a win and in for Lucas. Okay, so if Lucas wins this match, he is going to be in. And on the other side of the table, it's likely that Dimitrius will be in as well if he makes it, though it's not quite a lock because he's actually got four losses here. This is Lucas playing down with only three losses on his record. So a good start here for Lucas. He's playing Mardu Vehicles, and you can see he's got a one drop and a two drop on his side here, so looking pretty good.
So this is it, Marshall. These decks, they're both online here, right? This is what they want to be doing.
Yes.
Turn one, turn two in both cases here. On the left, we've got Thraben Inspector into Heart of Kirin. On the right, we've got Winding Constrictor. So, from here, it's going to play out in a couple different ways. Either Lucas leverages the fact that he's on the play and he's able to just continue building on his board position here and get out in front, or Dimitrius has an explosive turn, say, with Rishkar into Walking Ballista, something along those lines, and really just kind of explodes and comes back. Or the third way can play out as we start seeing the interaction come through the removal spells with each player trying to break up the other. But it looks like we do see Aether Sphere Harvester coming down. Okay, so we saw a little bit of the stack activation there. So Aether Sphere Harvester comes down, Thraben Inspector crews it with a crew cost of one, and then the Harvester actually crews the Heart of Kirin, which gets it immediately.
That's right. Speaking of Aether Sphere Harvester, here's a copy of it for Dimitrius as well. He's going to get three energy thanks to the Winding Constrictor, but he's going to leave it back on defense, as you might imagine here. The vehicle, very good blocker in this scenario, and he's just kept his Winding Constrictor at bay, and he's going to use it to crew his vehicle to block. So let's see how this plays out. Well, there's a veteran motorist, which is pretty annoying from Dimitrius' standpoint, as that can crew the Heart of Kirin, make it into a 5-5, which gets nicely past the 3-5 body of the opposing vehicle there.
Yeah, so we're actually seeing both players with pretty removal light, interaction light hands here. They're both just kind of doing their thing, playing out creatures and vehicles. And, you know, the advantage here, I think, is going to Lucas here in the early game, at least, both from being on the play and having just a little bit more of an efficient curve out here. Dimitrius, unfortunately, not able to take advantage of the Winding Constrictor's +1/+1 counter synergies just yet. Probably looking for something like a Walking Ballista or a Rishkar off the top to really leverage that. But here, indeed, as you said, Marshall, we have that veteran motorist crewing up Heart of Kirin, making it a 5-5, which comes in challenging the 3-5 stats of the Aether Sphere Harvester, which, you know, is unable to profitably block there. So Dimitrius falling down to 10 already and having quite some work to do to crawl out of this hole.
Neither of these players is super experienced here at the Pro Tour level, though Lucas is the much more experienced player. This is his 6th Pro Tour. He won an RPTQ to get here.
Okay.
On the other side of the table, though, Dimitrius from Greece, this is actually his first Pro Tour.
All right. Well, good for him getting so far and, you know, potentially making a run for the top 8 here.
Yeah, he won this invitation on Magic Online. But he's still got some work to do if he's going to convert this first Pro Tour experience into a top 8, which really is the dream. I mean,
oh yeah,
you win that, or you get into a top 8 on your first one, and you know, you all but lock up coming back to multiple Pro Tours after that, and it can be a real springboard for a pro Magic career.
Yeah, I actually love seeing this here, playing for the top 8 of the Pro Tour. We have an RPTQ winner and a Magic Online winner, right?
Yes.
That's like, how aspirational does it get, right? Like, that could be you sitting at home on your sofa playing Magic Online and eventually making your way to the Pro Tour.
Yeah, it's
so
fantastic.
Really cool to see that.
Okay. Dimitrius still sitting back on defense here as he plays a couple of Scrap Heap Scroungers. But once again, this Heart of Kirin can just attack right through.
Yeah, again, it's a 5-5.
Keeps taking it.
Just goes right through that 3-5 blocker. At some point, the Aether Sphere Harvester can jump in the way and maybe pay an energy, gain 3 life, but that is not where Dimitrius wants to be here.
Meantime, Lucas is just going to keep building out his board.
Maybe the best thing Dimitrius could come up with here is like a Fatal Push or something to take out that Heart of Kirin. Also, maybe a Rishkar or some other way to put +1/+1 counters, maybe boosting the Aether Sphere Harvester a little bit.
Let's see what he comes up with.
Looks like a Sylvan Advocate there. Not really too much help here, again, because really where the battle is happening here is in the air.
This is not a great situation for Dimitrius, who's finds himself pretty significantly behind in this game.
Yeah, unfortunately, this may be the turn where, you know, Dimitrius just has to kind of sheepishly pass the turn and then just put his Aether Sphere Harvester in the way, spend an energy, gain 3 life, and then at that point, he absolutely needs to top deck a removal spell.
Right, he'll buy himself 2 draw steps by doing that, but...
And here, Lucas can even send in his own Aether Sphere Harvester this turn, potentially.
Oh, yeah.
Well, then again, maybe not, because then the other Aether Sphere Harvesters block each other and gains life, and then Dimitrius can keep his around for another turn. So I guess it's probably better if he just sends in only the 5-5 Heart of Kirin.
Yeah, you're right, and it forces him to make a block in the air.
There's a little bit of psychology there, because you have to think about, oh, what if Dimitrius has a removal spell? But if he had one, he probably would have played it on a previous turn rather than taking the lines that he did. So I think the safe thing for Lucas is just go ahead and crew up that Heart of Kirin with Veteran Motorist, send it in, and force a jump block.
I have to say, Winding Constrictor and Heart of Kirin have really been the most impressive cards in Standard on the weekend for me, outside of the Sahili Guardian combo.
Yeah, I think even surpassing the Saheeli Feldar Guardian combo.
Definitely. I have seen Heart of Kirin do a lot of damage in the feature match area, and that Whining Constrictor has been responsible for some just outright ridiculous stuff. Now, this is interesting. Lucas is actually going to go ahead and attack with his Aether Sphere Harvester, but you know, I thought that the situation that you described made a lot of sense there, Ian, as well, where this actually allows Dimitrius to put his Aether Sphere Harvester in front of the other Harvester here, if you'd like. Go ahead and give it lifelink. Yeah, they both will. That's going to put Dimitrius at virtual 8, drop him down to 3 here. But yeah, he still has the Harvester.
Yeah, I'm not sure I love that play there. Yeah, I mean, it's debatable. Again, you have to think about it from Lucas's perspective. He doesn't know what Dimitrius has in his hand. So there are definitely arguments to be made for taking that line. And either way, you know, we'd still be at least a turn away from Lucas closing out the game.
That's
anyway.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So certainly defensible, and certainly Lucas still very much in the driver's seat here with Dimitrius needing to come up with probably multiple answers at this point. Looks like he did top deck.
Wow, how annoying. He top decked a Grasp of Darkness, but...
Well, this is not so bad, actually, because...
He can just block and eat it?
He can block and eat it and still get the lifelink.
Okay, I like that. Okay.
You know, so say Lucas makes the same attack again, Dimitrius can go... Okay, I'll go ahead and block the Heart of Kirin this time. I'll Grasp a Darkness it. I'll give my Aether Sphere Harvester lifelink. I'll take 3 from yours. I'll gain 3 from mine. I'll still end up at 3. And now your Heart of Kirin dies. And then now, you know, we have 2 Aether Sphere Harvesters facing off.
And that's a much more tenable situation for Dimitrius, as that gives him a lot more time to find some action here. He also looks like he may be lining up an attack here. The Sylvan Advocate's now... 4-5 mode, and he's got those 2 Scrap Heap Scroungers.
Yeah, and this is really interesting. So with the Veteran Motorist tapped, even though the Heart of Kirin is untapped, if it does get crewed, it's actually vulnerable to the Grasp of Darkness this turn.
Good point. So also, you know, I think if I'm sitting in Lucas's seat, that this starts to look like desperation, right? Like, you look at Dimitrius, and he's just like, oh, he's just lining up some attack because he knows he's going to die soon, and he has to do something.
Right.
Now, as it stands... Yeah. Lucas has a nice little block here with a Needle Spires. He activates that and just gobbles up one of the Scroungers. Does not risk his Heart of Kirin.
You know, that said, Marshall, we have seen quite a few games this weekend where, you know, we're talking about how advantaged one player is and then the other player makes a desperation attack and then somehow, miraculously, through top decks and good combat maneuvering, that actually turns into a race where the losing player ends up winning. I think I've seen that at least twice here this weekend. Mm-hmm. So, you know... This game is certainly not settled yet. There are definitely sequences of draws and events that could lead to Dimitrius winning this. So, you know, first things first, we have that Grasp of Darkness still in hand for Dimitrius. He's going to try to use that as a surprise in combat here. Leverage the lifelink of the Aether Sphere Harvester. Okay, Motorist is crewing up Heart of Kirin, making it a 5-5. Thraven Inspector crewing up Aether Sphere Harvester. That's a 3-5. They're coming in. So this is just the attack that I described last turn here. And I think what Dimitrius wants to do is go ahead and block the Heart of Kirin first, Grasp of Darkness it, reducing it to a 1-1, and then activating the lifelink ability on the Aether Sphere Harvester, and that'll let him go plus 3, minus 3, and stay at 3 life. Sorry.
Okay, well, stage 1 complete. He has activated the Aether Sphere Harvester. It is crewed by a snake of all things.
There's a joke there somewhere, but we're not going to make it.
No, just the visuals. You know. Dimitrius, of course, considering the things that Lucas could have in hand here as well, though... We have the luxury of actually just looking at his hand, and right now it's a pair of lands. Okay, they both give lifelink, and there it is. The Grasp of Darkness that Dimitrius drew last turn has now paid dividends here, and he's going to stay at a comfy 3 life, and he's actually stabilized this board.
And taking a look at hands here, it looks like Lucas just sitting on a couple of lands. Actually, just 1 land now, having played his for the turn. So you know, could really come down to top decks here. I still like the advantage here for Lucas, but anything could happen from this point in the game.
Is Dimitrius starting to get aggressive here? He's looking at a Hissing Quagmire there, it looks like.
Yeah, do you remember those creature lands get pumped up by Sylvan Advocate?
Of course.
Now with six lands in the battlefield.
Yeah, it's been a while since we've played Magic with Sylvan Advocate.
But that's true. So definitely one of the dominant cards in Standard, you know, as of a couple seasons ago, kind of fell out of favor a little bit, but is seeing some play again now, largely due to synergy with Rishkar and Winding Constrictor and that whole package there.
Lucas says, well, I've got a lot of life total to play with here, so I'm just going to take it. That's 8 damage. He falls down to 10. That's a big hit.
Yeah, this could be yet another one of those games where one player falls behind really early and then just kind of barely stabilizes, sets up a race, and is able to do it. But we'll see what comes off the top here for Lucas. You know, could be an unlicensed disintegration suddenly out of nowhere. A lot of things could happen here in these next couple turns.
Lucas is lining up all of his attacks to say, well, now how much can I actually do here? Because remember, he's got that Needle Spires down there too.
All right, Toolcraft Exemplar is getting pumped up. Needle Spires getting activated. Did the Needle Spires attack?
Yeah, I don't know. That was weird.
Okay.
I agree with your opponent. That is to say,
he activated it and clearly, you know, intended at some point to attack, but when he actually declared his attackers, he didn't turn it sideways.
Yeah, the question is just like, you know, did he finalize his attackers? Did he verbally say something? Or was it just, you know, he turned 4 sideways and then in a second motion added the fifth one to it?
You know, Ian, I think
he did. Depends a lot on the details. Depends a lot on the details.
Yeah, no, I'm saying based on what I'm seeing here, it looks like we're going to blocks.
Oh, I see.
Yeah,
okay.
And there was a judge. I saw a judge hand come in and make a pretty quick ruling there, and I don't think that Needle Spires gets to attack here. It's lethal, too. You know, on its own. I mean, I'm not saying he would win the game on the spot, but...
Yeah, it actually does look like that way. If Dimitrius didn't have anything in hand, I don't think he has anything in hand, it'd be the Aethersphere Harvester getting through as well as the Needle Spires.
Which would be game.
Which would be game there.
Oh, no.
So it looks like there were some blocks there as well as a shock in addition.
Oh, that is so punishing. He forgot to attack with his Needle Spires, and it is costing him dearly here.
Scrap Heap Scrounger jumps out of the graveyard at the end of the turn there. And then we have Hissing Quagmire, and that's game.
Oh, and that's
game.
The crackback.
Wow.
Dimitrius.
Unbelievable.
Picks up a game. What a gift he receives here. This could be huge. Remember, this is potentially a top 8 winning match for Dimitrius, and it absolutely is for Lucas. He is going to be very frustrated with himself after that oversight, but he's got to gather himself and pick up 2 game wins in a row to put himself in the top 8. I tell you what, we've got a lot more Magic lined up for you right after these messages.
Put what you've learned from watching the Pro Tour into action and compete to become the champion of your favorite game store. Test your skills and your new Standard deck at Game Day. Top finishers are awarded special Game Day prizes, including Full Art Premium promo cards and a champion playmat for the winner. Aether Revolt is now available in Magic Duels. Build endless deck combinations with more than 1,000 unique cards. Play through hours of story with over 50 campaign missions. Play Magic Duels free today on Xbox One, Steam, iPad, and iPhone.
And welcome back to the feature match area here at Pro Tour Aether Revolt. I've got some updates for you from our side matches. First and foremost, the one directly behind our feature match, our main feature match, I should say, is Ivan Flock versus Samuel Tharmaratnam. That one's over. The match.
Wow.
Yeah, that one ended already. You won't be shocked, though, because it was Mardu Vehicles versus Black-Red Aggro, so it was a real kind of race to the finish there, and Ivan Flock ended up winning that match 2-0 to finish 12-4.
Okay.
I believe his tiebreakers are not amenable to a top eight, but I wouldn't sign my name on that. You know how these things go down the stretch.
Yeah, taking a look at things, he doesn't have necessarily the highest tiebreakers, but they're within range where things could fluctuate a little bit. So
yeah, the two actually highest tiebreakers of the group that are at the record that he's at are Paulo Vitor Damo de Rosa and Dimitrius that we were watching here, and we're going to get going on again in a minute here. They're actually the first and second seeds, not in that order though. Dimitrius is first and then Paulo. Speaking of Paulo Vitor Damo de Rosa, he is playing Ben Rubin in the feature match area. That is a Hall of Fame mirror. That's black green delirium, I should say, for Ben Rubin versus Mardu Vehicles for Paulo. Paulo's up a game in that one too. Paulo is very live here for top eight.
Yeah, we think that, you know, the winner of this Dimitrius versus Lucas match that we're just watching right now is very likely to top eight if they win. And we think that the winner of the Ben Rubin versus Paulo Vitor Damo de Rosa match is very likely to top eight. But again, take this all with a grain of salt. There's some fuzzy tiebreaker math going on here. Anything could change from time to time. You know, even Flock, as we mentioned, is possibly still in the mix as well. So don't take anything that we're saying here as a definite, you know, that someone's a lock. But yeah, a lot of exciting stuff going on here at the feature match area. And we're off to game number two here.
Yeah, we've got a scrap heap scrounger, I should say, there for Lucas. A couple of interesting interactions down the stretch on that last game. Of course, we mentioned that oversight by Lucas. There was also an interaction with a creature getting blocked by an Aether Sphere Harvester. And if you kill your own creature before damage happens, then they'll never actually get the lifelink damage.
And I see. So what you're saying is even after the mistake with not attacking with the creature land, the Needle Spires, there still may have been an opportunity to, you know, for Lucas to shock his own creature to prevent the lifelink, and maybe that could cause a win as well. So lots of stuff going on there in that last exchange, and you know, potentially some mistakes being made, but we'll have to go back and take a look at that later and see exactly how that all played out.
Yeah, this is a very high-pressure situation for the players in our feature match area. It is not uncommon.
So here we have a situation, the dreaded situation, where Dimitrius is able to untap with Winding Constrictor. Let's see what he can do with that here. I think I do see a Rishgar Pima Renegade in his hand, which, you know, could be an awesome addition to the board. Instead goes with Nissa, Voice of Zendikar, also fantastic with Winding Constrictor. And I think you know, he may have decided for the Nissa rather than the Rishgar, because Lucas has three untapped mana, which could represent, you know, anything from Unlicensed Disintegration to, you know, combination of Shock or Fatal Push or anything along those lines, and, you know, just not wanting to put all of his eggs in one basket, kind of diversifying his threats here with the Planeswalker. Plant jumps in the way of Scrap Heap Scrounger, preserving Nissa's loyalty.
Ooh.
But down comes Chandra,
wow,
Torture Defiance.
Yeah, so Chandra's going to take care of the Winding Constrictor here and really put the pressure back on Dimitrius. He's got another Winding Constrictor in his hand. But this is interesting, too, because he also has a Walking Ballista, and boy, would he love to use one of those counters to make sure that Chandra doesn't stick around for
another
turn.
Yeah, I mean, ideal situation would be if he had a fourth land, he could play Winding Constrictor, play the Ballista on two counters, spend one counter to kill Chandra, and then he'd be in fantastic shape from there. Unfortunately, not the case. I mean, you know, another option he has is to play the Ballista, could maybe tick down Nissa, put an extra counter on it, shoot the Chandra.
I kind of like that line. And then, you know, the next turn he can play the Winding Constrictor.
Problem then
Nissa
is
again.
If he made that play, he'd be priced into blocking the Scrap Heap Scrounger with the Walking Ballista anyway, so that's not really that fruitful. Instead, just decides to kind of turtle up a little bit here, make a plant, drop the Winding Constrictor there, and hope that survives for a turn. And this is kind of a hold-your-breath moment for Dimitrius.
Absolutely. This seems pretty reasonable.
Chandra ticks up, reveals a land, which you cannot play, so is forced to do the two damage. That gets redirected to Nissa.
Right. And, of course, the plant token is going to save the Planeswalker here by jumping in front. But I got to say, Lucas still needs some more action here to get the job done. Okay, that's a start. You got more than that, Lucas? You do. A couple of one drops. Nothing super exciting here. Wow. Okay, that was a pretty good turn. He put a dent in the loyalty of Nissa and played three spells that turn.
Yeah, no kidding. So again, Dimitrius would love to see a fourth land here just to play multiple cards in the same turn. Looks like he does not pick that up, but does have the Walking Ballista on the battlefield, the Winding Constrictor on the battlefield, you know, to leverage here with the +1/+1 counter synergy. We could see Rishkar putting, you know, +1/+1 counters on both the Rishkar and the Winding Constrictor. And then, you know, a Nissa activation in either direction would also be potent at that point. We could see Walking Ballista come down with two counters, and then a Nissa activation sending it up to four. That could take out Chandra and, you know, maybe take out Thraben Inspector or the Scrap Heap Scrounger. There's a lot of flexibility here. Looks like we do have that Rishkar.
Yep. Rishkar could be a very important piece here. And it looks like Dimitrius is going to try to diversify.
So, yeah, this is okay. Shores up the ground a little bit. It does leave Nissa vulnerable to an attack from Aether Sphere Harvester plus Chandra ticking up. So I think sort of no matter what Dimitrius has to do, he has to make a concession to probably losing the Nissa that turn.
Yeah, that's a bummer. You know, when you've already got the Winding Constrictor out there, just even one minus from Nissa, oh, it's so devastating. But
yeah,
he couldn't do it all. You know, when you have mana issues, it really does limit what you can do in a game. And you can see already five lands for Lucas on the other side and Dimitrius. Now, when he gets to untap, assuming he still has Rishkar out there, well, he's going to have a lot of mana then.
Okay, so this was Chandra ticking up, and actually the two damage was not redirected to Nissa, which indicates to me Veteran Motorist. Yeah, exactly. And that's going to boost the power of the Aether Sphere Harvester up to four, taking out Nissa anyway. So just kind of maximizing the damage distribution there. And man, what a world of difference would we have in this game if Dimitrius was able to hit his fourth land, last turn or even the turn prior. I mean, he would have just exploded this game with, you know, Rishkar mana and Walking Ballista going bananas, all kinds of stuff here. But yeah, unfortunately, a little constrained on mana. And, you know, I'm going to say, you know, things are looking pretty good here for Lucas, although, you know, we're far from conclusion on this game just yet. So there is that fourth land, unfortunately, enters the battlefield tapped. And we'll see if we can take a look here at Dimitrius's hand. He's got a few options here.
Does he have? Walking Ballista. That's a nice one with the Constrictor out.
Yeah, I was going to say he has Ruinous Path, but he actually doesn't have double black for that this turn here. So, you know, his options here are just limited to Sylvan Advocate or Walking Ballista.
And Walking Ballista if he wants.
Yes, because, of course, there is that Rishkar out, so he could tap, you know, Plant, for example, to get an extra green.
That does look pretty powerful here. Of course, the Chandra still being around, really annoying for Dimitrius.
Yeah, and it's ticked back up to three again, so it can actually, you know, deal four damage to a creature as well. You know, for example, taking out Rishkar, further constraining mana. Lots of options here.
Boy, an attack by Winding Constrictor. Skywhaler shot for Lucas. That's a beating. As it stood, Lucas did have ways to interact. Anyway, he could chump block, for example. But instead, he's just going to shoot that snake right out of the air.
Yeah, I think that's a huge, huge tip of the scales in the favor of Lucas here.
I think so, too. So Dimitrius' plan then becomes, okay, fine, I'm going to play Walking Ballista post-combat for two, use one of the counters to take down your Veteran Motorist, but again, Chandra's just still happily ticking upwards, generating card advantage, sometimes doing damage.
Yeah, Chandra's been doing a ton of work this game.
Oh, man, that one window when she was at one loyalty and Dimitrius just couldn't find that land was so savage.
Yeah, I mean, even looking back, you know, it may have been worth just playing the Walking Ballista for one and just shooting Chandra.
Yes, I think that went through Dimitrius' mind. It's a tough pill to swallow when you have the snake out there.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's one of those things like, you know, you gotta play to win rather than play to not lose, right? I think he could have just played the Walking Ballista, killed the Chandra, but he would have fallen so far behind in tempo that I think even though it's a ostensibly greedier play, of playing the Winding Constrictor first. I think that gives him the most potential to kind of surge out into the lead from there.
Yeah, and you know, looking at his line here, yes, he's under significant pressure, but his hand looks pretty good now that he's got double black. You know, he's got a Kalatas, Trader of Get, and a Ruinous Path, plus a Grasp of Darkness. Now, he is going to be crimped where he can only play one of those per turn, but these are powerful spells he has access to if he can just hang on.
Yep, the lifelink on Kalatas being especially important there, as well as actually the exile ability, very relevant against Scrap Heap Scrounger.
Yeah.
So he is going to take a big chunk of damage likely this turn here.
He's still behind. Yeah, you weren't kidding about that. He is taking a beating.
So it looks like five comes through. Walking Ballista gets in front of the Scrap Heap Scrounger. You know, pings Chandra, I think knocks her down to three. Five comes through, knocks Dimitrius down to seven. And, you know, he can untap and play Kalatas, but how much does that even help him here?
What if I added a Rish card to the equation? Would that help? It does let him cast two spells this turn. He can play Sylvan Advocate and Rishkar.
But he has to play the Rishkar first, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He does.
And then he also has to tap his plant, which is one of his blockers. So nothing's looking super clean here.
No.
I think, you know, and even if he plays Kalatas, Chandra's there sitting at three loyalty, able to deal four damage to the Kalatas.
Just and blast him.
Yeah, I don't see many good options here, or really any good options, I should say.
Yeah, Dimitrius all the way down to seven life, looking significantly behind on board.
Yeah, we may see a chance for redemption here for Lucas after that that first game that sort of swung, you know, dramatically against him there in that final turn.
Oh, he's gotta want that so bad to get another chance, right? I mean, we all make mistakes like that, overlook something, and you just want to get another chance at it. And Lucas is fighting for that right now.
Yeah, you have a moment like that, and all that's going through your head is not like this.
Yes, not like this. Looks like Sylvan Advocate's all he's going to play. That does allow him to leave up Grasp of Darkness here. Oh, man.
Sky Sovereign
for Lucas.
Boom.
Is going to just snap off the 2-3 Sylvan Advocate and make life very difficult. In fact, likely lethal here. Let's see what happens. He cashed in his Chandra to kill the plant token. But remember, Dimitrius does have a Grasp of Darkness. Does that let him stay alive? 2, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's still lethal, even through the Grasp of Darkness. That is Lucas Esper Berthoud picking up game number two. He's on that path to redemption. He had a mistake in game one. He activated a creature land and just didn't see it when he went to attack. And then it was too late for him to attack. And that may have cost him the game. It doesn't have to cost him the match. If he can win this last game, he could put himself in a good position there.
This has been an intense series, Marshall. I mean, you know, aside from sort of the mistake that we saw in game one, just really intricate combat math, really small details of sequencing coming down to deciding the games here. You know, we talked about that missing that fourth land drop being just instrumental there on the side of Dimitrius in that second game. So really eager to see that third game and see how things shape up, you know, with both players giving it their all.
Okay, so let's jump over to our other table, the only other table we have still going in our feature match area. And this is a big, big, big match as well. This is Paulo Vitor Dominarosa versus Ben Rubin. And we are talking about two Hall of Famers going at it. And there is a darn good chance that this ends up being a win and in. I mentioned earlier that when it came to tiebreakers for this group, they happen to be on 33 match points, meaning 11 wins right now, that Dimitrius is actually the top of that group with Paulo Vitor Dominarosa being the second. Well, Ben Rubin is the third. So that means that the winner of this match has a very good chance to top eight this tournament. They're not a lock, but, you know, having the you know, you're knocking out Paulo Vitor Dominarosa to get there. You're going to bump him out, and, you know, then that puts you in a good spot tiebreakers-wise because you were ahead of everybody else going in. You are likely to stay that way, though, like you mentioned earlier. It's not a lock.
So far, looking like pretty good draws for both players here. Paulo following up on the draw here. He had a turn one Toolcraft Exemplar into turn two Thraben Inspector.
Whoa!
Also, wow, with a Fatal Push, taking out that Sylvan Advocate and crack it in for 3 damage. So
yeah, you know, this is a good start.
We talk about these turns where you can cast 2 spells in the same turn, or you know, sort of counteract your opponent's play for a mana advantage, just being so huge the way these games play out. And wow, did Ben miss his land drop there?
Yeah, I do believe he did. I see that Paulo has now untapped, and this could be sad and fast. If Paulo just has any reasonable sequence of plays here this turn, he is going to put Ben Rubin significantly behind, and this one could be slipping away from a Hall of Famer on the right pretty quickly.
Yeah, really unfortunate for Ben Rubin there. You can see he did have a couple Grim Flayers in his hand, but with just Forest and Aether Hub and no energy to spend. Well, unable to play any black spells.
There is good news for Ben Rubin fans here. Paulo actually isn't doing a whole lot. He's just going to play another Thraben Inspector and leave up the mana for a clue, it looks like. So, and there's a land off the top for Ben.
Ooh. Okay.
We might have ourselves a game again here. That one looked like it may slip away, but that was not a super great turn for Paulo last turn, and that means a swamp off the top specifically as well. Let's Ben play a Grim Flayer.
And I'll also point out, if we look at Ben Rubin's hand there, he does have some tools that are pretty good at catching up. Rishkar, Pima Renegade, you know, able to kind of catapult his mana if he has time to do that. And then specifically Ishkana, Graph Widow. If he's able to get to Delirium somehow and get that Ishkana going, you know, maybe he spends a turn attacking with Grim Flayer when he otherwise would hang back to block just to try to get to Delirium. But if he can land that Ishkana on turn 5 and make all those spiders, you know, that's a potential route where he can get back in this game. Meanwhile, we are here on Paulo's turn. He's untapping and thinking here. Didn't have too much of an explosive turn 3. Just kind of played a 3-bit Inspector and cracked a clue, and now kind of pondering his options here. We'll see if we can take a look at his hand. Looking a little bit mana flooded there with a bunch of lands in hand, but he does have interaction with Unlicensed Disintegration, and he does have a Gideon, so we'll see that Gideon come down here post-combat, and that is not a card you want to see on the other side of the table when you're this far behind from Ben Rubin's standpoint.
Right, that is the hammer that we were talking about. The last turn was a little bit anemic, but here, Gideon, Ally of Zendikar, when you're this far behind, extends the lead so much, and this is all that Ben Rubin can muster is a Rishkar. This one is starting to slip away very quickly. Here comes Unlicensed Disintegration to Boom. Knock Ben down to 10, and this should be lethal. That's 7, actually it's 9, isn't it? 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 puts you to 1, so it's not quite lethal, but realistically...
Yeah, I think Ben's drawing dead at this point.
I do too. Paulo, Vitor, Damo de Rosa. Now, he does have to sweat the tiebreakers, but this could be top 8 number 11
wow.
for the Hall of Famer here if he is fortunate enough to get in on breakers. Paulo just says, yeah, sure, you did it. And all he has to do is go through the motions and get this one last attack in, and he is going to win this match. Again, Paulo is one of the players with 4 losses already, but we do predict that one or two players on 4 losses is going to make it into the top 8, and Paulo is near the top of the tiebreaker heap for that. I would not be shocked to see him in. He's not a lock, though.
And Paulo, of course, playing for Team Channel Fireball Ice, one of the top teams, you know, coming into this tournament, and actually, you know, we chose as our team of the day yesterday, so awesome to see him representing them. Potentially heading into the top.
Yeah, you're going to see some Channel Fireball Icers are coming up on the stage. In fact, I think they're being ushered back off of it. But I did see some of the teammates up there, an Eric Froelich, there's an Andre Strosky as well, excited, jumping around on the sideline here. And they're going to wait for Paulo to come back down. Wow. If Paulo makes another top, I mean, how insane is this guy's career?
Yeah. I mean, 11 top eights.
Yeah, well, I'll be doing the top 8 announcement after this round is fully over, and I can't wait to see that sheet, I'll tell you that. I'll look right down at the bottom and see who the 7th and 8th seeds are as they're coming into tomorrow's top 8 coverage. But we are not done yet. We are not done yet in the feature match area. We still have Dimitrius versus Lucas here, and this is a big, big one. I'm happy to see Lucas shrug off that game 1 and continue with his winning ways.
See Dimitrius kind of slow rolling himself as he picks up his hand there. Looks like he is on a mulligan to 6, I think.
Yeah, he is. He was just resolving his scry there. And he put the card back on top of his library. He is on the play in this matchup. Again, this is a Black Green Constrictor versus Mardu Vehicles.
And we're going to start with a small advantage there in the favor of Lucas, kind of representing that he did not mulligan. He's on 7 cards, Dimitrius on 6. Of course, that could turn around very quickly depending on their early draws here. Taking a look at Lucas's hand there, he's got another veteran motorist to play next turn, a little bit of interaction in form of Skywhaler's shot into some big threats, Chandra and Sky Sovereign. So pretty well-balanced hand there with mana to cast.
Yeah, you gotta love those hands because, or those type of cards in hand, because that those are the ones that tend to clean up the mess. And we have seen that these boards tend to get a little stalled out, a little, I can't really attack, or maybe I can chip in with one vehicle, but you know, when you start playing Sky Sovereigns, well, that cleans it up pretty nicely.
And Skywhaler's shot in particular being a really good answer to Aether Sphere Harvester.
Yeah.
You know, especially after a creature is committed to crew it, and then, you know, exactly hitting the 3 power there, getting a scry off of it as well.
Look at this. Passing the turn back is Dimitrius. He is not going to bother crewing up. He's just on defense here all the way. That did strand 3 mana in hand for Lucas. You know, I wouldn't have been surprised to see Dimitrius just go ahead and crew up his Harvester and attack there, but he did not. I think he knew better.
Yeah, playing around, you know, Unlicensed Disintegration or Skywhaler's shot, I think, which he saw last game, I want to say. In any case, here comes Chandra, I believe, for Lucas.
A little bit awkward of a position here. He'd like to take care of the Sylvan Advocate, but if he does, and if Dimitrius has any creature in his deck, then he just loses Chandra to that Harvester next turn.
So let's rewind real quick and look at that last turn, because that was really, really impactful. So correct me if I'm wrong, but Lucas could have played a second Veteran Motorist, instead just passed the turn with 3 mana, leaving up Skywhaler's shot to challenge the Aether Sphere Harvester. Dimitrius played a creature, and then, you know, instead of the natural play of activating the Aether Sphere Harvester and attacking, he just did nothing instead, which made Lucas basically pass his third turn doing nothing here.
Stranded all that mana.
Now what that has translated into is, now that Chandra comes down on turn 4, has to minus to kill the Sylvan Advocate. Dimitrius now can play a follow-up creature, now can activate the Aether Sphere Harvester and take out the Chandra. This is a huge swing here, Marshall, compared to what could have been.
Yeah, Dimitrius with a really nice play there of just passing the turn back and not falling for that trap.
All of this would have been so different had he played that turn 3 differently.
And now look at his board. He's at 20 life versus the Mardu Vehicles deck. Now there's going to be a Sky Sovereign here, I'm assuming. Yeah, and that's going to finish off the Ballista. But still, nice play there from Dimitrius, and let's see if he can capitalize on it, because he still has a lot of work to do. Chandra, you know, still killed a creature.
Mm-hmm.
Sky Sovereign's still there now. It's not all over here, but I do like that play from Dimitrius. That was nice.
So let's take a look at Dimitrius's hand here. This is his turn beginning here. He doesn't have that fourth land, I don't think. He's got a lot of power in his hand. He'd love to get that Kalitas and Verdurous Gearhulk going. Instead, just sitting on a little bit of interaction here in the form of Fatal Push and Grasp of Darkness, which neither of which is super well suited to handle that Sky Sovereign, unfortunately. So despite, you know, really, really good effort in the early game here, still, you know, being hamstrung by not hitting that fourth land. On the flip side here, Lucas adding Veteran Motorist to the battlefield. Doing a little bit of scrying, keeping both on top.
That's, wow,
that's not
scary.
Something you want to see from Dimitrius' standpoint. Sky Sovereign gets crewed. It's a 6/5, I do believe, which makes it immune to both Grasp of Darkness and Fatal Push.
It's actually a 7/6 here.
Oh, 7/6, right, because the +1/+1 from Veteran Motorist.
Right. But huge attacker, I mean.
And this has got to be a frustrating spot for Dimitrius, because, you know, he passed a turn, spent no mana, has 2 removal spells up, still can't really do anything that great with them.
He can just take out that Veteran Motorist, but the damage is done.
Yeah.
Now it's Gideon, and the bombs are piling up. You know, we mentioned this at the onset of the game. Yeah, there was some nice interactions early, but when your opponent just starts playing these haymakers, what are you supposed to do?
Yeah, and again, you know, really comes down to missing that fourth land. You know, had Dimitrius' last turn been, okay, I'll play Kalitas, and then maybe the turn after that I'll play Verdurous Gearhulk and load it up with a bunch of counters. You know, that this is a much different game from that standpoint.
Yeah, these land drops are really catching up to him. but he's going to just empty his hand of two removal spells there and leave Lucas with, well, still two powerful cards, and all that Dimitrius can do is get in and attack Gideon. The unfortunate part is that Gideon still stays alive even after the hit from the Aether Sphere Harvester. It's a nice life swing and a good play from Dimitrius to try to buoy his life total as much as possible, but oh, the difference between 3 and 4 is so huge there.
Yeah, and then remember, you know, because of that early sequence, Lucas still has that Skywhaler shot in his hand, which Dimitrius isn't 100% certain about, but did, you know, he did play around, so he's still probably thinking about that. And that could either just take out the Kalitas right now, or even unlaces Disintegration. Okay.
Yeah, multiple removal spells here. And then kind of interesting, Lucas can just go ahead and turn Gideon into a creature and then attack with the Sky Sovereign. It attacks for an extra point of damage.
No, he's not going to. Instead.
He's just going to pass. Okay. He's prioritizing developing his board rather than slamming the door on the game. Verger's Gearhulk in hand for Dimitrius, but he did just draw a card for the turn as well. And he's kind of, oh, he's doing the slow squeeze. He even pulled it off camera so we couldn't see it. Okay, it was another Kalitas.
However, we know there's that Skywhaler shot. I'm sure we'll see that end of turn here.
Yeah.
Actually takes out that Easter Harvester. Yeah, protects the Gideon for a turn.
Right, Lucas wants to do it. I don't think he scryed there. Wow, he didn't need to.
I think he actually maybe knew it was already on top from the Veteran Motorist. Remember, he put two on top a couple turns ago.
There you go. So that's why he skipped the scry.
Yep.
He already knew it was there, and bang, things are slipping away from Dimitrius and quickly. Oh, baby. Take 6, drop to 7. Lucas Esper Berthoud is on the verge here.
Here it is. Probably the final draw step here for Dimitrius. I'm not even sure what, you know, what he's looking for here, what saves him. We know he has that Verdurous Gearhulk in his hand. You know, a fifth land Verdurous Gearhulk doesn't really help him here at all. He's still going to get smashed by that Sky Sovereign. So what can he find?
I don't think there's many cards that save him at this point. So he's just going to play an 8-8 Gearhulk and pass the turn back. You saw that check of the hand there from Lucas.
So he can just crew the Sky Sovereign with Gideon and attack with the two knights, for example. And that should be lethal, right?
On board. Indeed, that does it. Remember, Lucas is the one who only had 3 losses. He's controlling his own fate here. He will be in the top 8, and that's going to do it. Lucas Esper Berthoud wins the match and goes screaming off the stage to his friends. And why not? He is now in our top 8 here at Pro Tour Aether Revolt. And that's how you're supposed to act when you make a top 8.
Love it.
This is great stuff. Hugs, and of course, you got to hug the Godfather. That's Willie Adel down there.
Yeah, sort of a captain and, you know, kind of a leader for the South American Magic Community, Latin American.
You can see the whole Dex Army team. In fact, group of teams. Lucas plays for Dex 3rd, which is, as you might imagine, just one of the Dex Army teams over there. And huge congratulations to him. Everybody at home in Brazil, I'm sure, is super excited for him as well. This is the good stuff here, Ian. This is the fun part when we get to watch the big celebrations. Looks like he's getting pretty emotional down there, getting all those hugs from all of his friends and teammates.
Yeah, awesome stuff to see. This is where, you know, final round of Swiss is over. The emotion just really pours out after 2 grueling days of Magic. You know, 8-10 hours of play where players are trying so hard to hold in their emotions, not give any tells, you know, not give any body language. Finally breathing that sigh of relief at the end and just saying, all right, I crossed the finish line. This feels great.
Yeah, Dimitrius from Team Conflagrease is going to have to settle for an 11-5 finish here, but I have to say, that's a very strong showing. And, you know, that's going to add a lot of points to the team's total, and they're going to be pretty proud of him for that as well. I mean, this stuff all counts, you know, and you know, obviously that's a strong finish as well. Nothing to be ashamed of there. Of course, he's going to be disappointed in the moment, but there's a lot to be gained from these deep finishes. And, you know, when you look at it, I think over the course of a season worth of teams, you're going to see some people spike and make a top eight, and that's going to be kind of part of the equation. But what's really going to be important are these type of finishes.
Totally agree. Yeah, those, you know, 9th through 16th, you know, top 32 type finishes. They don't feel great in the moment when you miss your winning in, but at the end of the season, when you look back and you're like, wow, you know, thanks, buddy, for picking up those points. That was just what we needed there.
Exactly.
It all adds up, right?
All right, that's going to do it for our coverage here from the booth for the Swiss rounds. Now, the top eight is shaping up. We know some people are in. We are going to be bringing you announcements soon and to update you on everything that's been going on throughout the tournament floor. Let's head to the news desk and Brian David Marshall.
I'm sorry. You'll see, understand what I was looking at there. Big, big distraction down in the hall. That was amazing magic. I'm still like, you know, things are shaking here. Let's go down to the floor. Tim Willoughby, he caught up with Lucas Esper Berthoud after his amazing win and clinching his top eight berth.
Hello and welcome down to the floor here. There is absolute bedlam going on as another member of the Dex Army from D3. Lucas Esper Berthoud locking up his top eight spot. I don't even know if you can hear me over this crowd. Lucas, how does it feel to have such a team behind you, all supporting you as you make your top eight?
Oh, I love all of those guys. I've known them for over 10 years, most of them sharing the struggles of competitive magic. And playtesting with them is always a place of chaos, but warmth and friendship. And I'm really glad to share this moment with them.
It's a fantastic performance by the Dex Army. We've also got Marcio Carvalho in the top eight from the Dex Protection team. There's going to be a large amount of cheering, I'm sure, throughout the whole of this top eight here at Pro Tour Aether Revolt, with the Latin American contingent also happy to see Paolo Vitor Damo de Rosa locking up a slot of potentially making it in. He's going to be waiting on tiebreakers. The announcement for top eight is very, very shortly coming up. But congratulations to you, another member of the Dex Protection team, in this case, Team D3, all making it into the top eight. Heading back to the booth for you, Brian.
Oh, thanks.
They stole the team channel fireball chant.
Yeah, that's what they did.
That's pretty amazing. Seeing those guys show so much emotion and enthusiasm, you know, so much of a Magic tournament, I'm sure you can speak to this, is spent coiling, right? And coiling,
oh, yeah.
And coiling. And then to be able to let it go for one moment has got to be just an exhilarating experience.
Yeah, and one of the best parts about tournaments is seeing your friends do well. So it's awesome to see that Lucas has such a big cheering section behind him.
It looks like Mardu Vehicles. We just saw Lucas with Mardu Vehicles. It looks like Mardu Vehicles is going to be all over this top eight.
Yeah, it's interesting. Coming into the tournament, a lot of players played Mardu Vehicles because it had a good matchup against Saheeli. And we see no Saheeli decks anywhere near the top eight, it looks like.
When was the last time we even saw one in the feature match?
I never covered a Saheeli deck the whole weekend. And then part of the reason people played Black Green Constrictor is its matchup against Mardu Vehicles. Turns out if Mardu Vehicles is good against Saheeli and good against Black Green Constrictor, then maybe Mardu Vehicles is just the choice.
And so punishing if you miss a turn, right? That deck doesn't seem to give you one moment to breathe. What makes Heart of Cairn such a powerful card in this deck? Why it's a card people are playing four of and it's legendary.
Well, part of it, and the reason that Mardu Vehicles overall is so strong, is because it starts on turn one and a lot of other decks do not. You have turn one Toolcraft Exemplar or Thraven Inspector, or now Fatal Push. So, you know, I've seen games where Mardu Vehicles is on the draw, doesn't have one of its creature one drops. Fatal pushes the opponent's two drop, next turn plays like Heart of Cairn or Scrap Heap Scrounger, next turn plays Veteran Motorist and just gets ahead that way. Shock, also a card that some players are playing. We saw Paolo Vitor Damo de Rosa, you know, pilot Shocks in his match against Ben Rubin in this last round. And Heart of Cairn plays into it because it's a two drop that attacks for four on turn three, and you can crew it with your one drop with Toolcraft Exemplar.
Crazy. Now, players from all over the world play this deck. We saw players in North America, players in South America, and players from China, and Tim Willoughby is down on the floor with one of those players right now.
Hello and welcome down to the feature match area floor. I'm here with another one of our top eight competitors. He was one of our overnight leaders, that being Yuchen Liu. Now, obviously, you've already got five Grand Prix top eights. How does it feel to push through for your first Pro Tour top eight?
你已经有五次大奖赛八强的经验，那拿到专业赛大奖赛八强对专业赛的八强对你有什么感觉？感觉像在做梦一样，感觉不够真实的感觉，还在有点虚幻，还不敢相信这是真的。
I'm feeling very great. It's like a real, it's like dreaming. I still cannot believe it's true. Yeah.
Now, remind us what deck it was that you played during the Swiss. That's what you're going to be playing in the whole of the top eight. Are there any players or any matchups that you're worried about as well?
再告诉我们一次你在预赛打的构筑赛的套牌是什么套牌，因为这个套牌你将会在八强里面打。然后同时在八强中，你有没有哪个对手或哪样的对局是你比较不想要碰到的？那位葡萄牙的轮抓大师吗？RCO套牌，就是那个马尔都车吗？
Yeah, I'm playing vehicles and in top eight. A little bit. I don't want to meet the draft master, Marcio Carvalho. Yeah, I lost to him once, and yes, I don't want to beat him.
Not too many people, of course, that have defeated you in this tournament thus far. Worth noting also, you were the head of the Chinese team at the World Magic Cup. What does it mean for Chinese Magic to get another Pro Tour top eight?
你在世界杯是中国队长，那你觉得拿到专业赛八强，对于中国的万智牌社群有没有什么样的影响？
当然，我觉得会有一个正面的推动作用吧。虽然说中国的这个万智牌社群可能还相对来说比较小，但是我们同样可以成功。
Yeah, I believe there should be some positive effect, even we don't have that many player base. But yeah, we proved that Chinese player can also be successful in the Pro Tour.
Well, congratulations to another one of our Pro Tour top haters. I am now going to make an effort to congratulate you in the appropriate language. So, Gongxi, Jiayou.
Thank you very much.
Heading back to the booth.
Thank you, Tim. Great stuff to hear from players all over the world play Magic. We talked a little bit about that effect of the success breeding success, and maybe, you know, as we get a Chinese player here in the top eight, we'll start to see some more players following suit in the future. So what do you think is, where's your guess on this, last spot, maybe last two spots in the top eight? What are we looking at on a tiebreaker scenario here?
The players coming into the round, even Flock and Paulo Vitor Damo de Rosa, had the two highest tiebreakers of the people who won their last round. So it's likely a battle between those. Maybe a third player, a dark horse, can overtake them. But it looks like room for one player at 12-4.
Wow.
Because Lucas did win his pair down. So it's going to be a hotly contested spot. There were definitely players on both sides rooting for Lucas, like, to win or lose, because he might have opened up another slot had he lost.
And Dimitrius, I know, disappointed to lose, but a great showing by the Greek team. You know, he's going to end up with a top 25 finish. I know Panagiotis Papadopoulos had, I believe, a top 16 or a top 25-ish finish as well. It was looking like...
Yeah, he went 12-4, so presumably he's somewhere in the top 16.
Yeah. But you know what? We are ready to find out. I know you are anxiously awaiting to find out if your good friend is going to be in the top 8 or your other good friend is going to be in the top 8. Let's send it down to the floor.